Hello, Bioneers community. Really delighted to be here with you this morning. And I'm even more excited to tell you about this book. It's a project of my husband, David Montgomery, and I, our second collaboration. It'll be out this spring. And in it, we take a deep dive and a close look at this idea that we are what we eat. I know everyone is probably familiar with this phrase, we believe it, we believe in it. And we do too, but there's more to the story, and that is really what the subject of the new book is about. So what might be missing in that phrase? It has to do with this, with soil, and specifically with soil health. Much of the research that we did for the book includes just an extensive review of research and papers and scientists and farmers and taking a look into the different pathways and the different mechanisms by which soil health affects our health. I'm saddened to say soil health is not in a great place right now, but I am happy to say that we can turn this situation around. And the way that we can do that is through modifying farming practices to work better with what I call the biological bazaar. Now, this is a really cool, wild and alive place underneath our feet in the soil. And what's happening here is one of the grandest symbiotic partnerships that we know about through the history of life. When the first puny tiny plants came onto land, they plunged their roots into the soil, and what did they meet? They met the microorganisms, things like bacteria and fungi. And they struck up this partnership because plants could do things for the microbes that the microbes couldn't do, and microbes could do things that plants couldn't do, like fungi that could fetch minerals that were far off in the soil that plants couldn't reach. They would bring those back and exchange them for what are called exudates. These are basically a whole slew of different nutrients and compounds and molecules that fungi thrive on. And it's the same story with bacterial communities. They can't go and travel off the way that fungi can, so they're stuck right close to and sometimes inside of roots, doing all of these exchanges. And so this is this grand, grand partnership that we know about between plants and soil life. And the good thing about that partnership is that when soil health is normal and it's functioning and the biological bazaar is a thriving, wild and alive place, those compounds, those minerals, those molecules that soil life helps plants take in, it transfers through to the food, food that we eat, and food that animals in the human diet eat. And it eventually ripples through into our bodies. And one of the most important kinds of compounds that soil life and healthy soils influence in our crops is the production of phytochemicals. Plants are basically these sedentary crafters of thousands, tens of thousands of different kinds of chemicals. And what we know about phytochemicals in plants is that they serve an array of different protective and defensive purposes. So anything from dealing with the ultraviolet light in sun that they're exposed to their entire lives to pushing back on, say, insect pests. Phytochemicals play roles in those and many, many other things. And in addition, we know that healthy soils are really important for micronutrient uptake in plants. And so micronutrients are one of these things, we need them in just tiny amounts, but these tiny amounts do really important and powerful things. And three micronutrients in particular, the soil microbiome influences how plants take these in. So if we have healthy soils, these are the kinds of micronutrients that are making it into the plant and animal foods that make up the human diet. And speaking of biological bazaars, in our ruminants, so these are our cows, sheep, and goats. They have one of the most complicated and amazing and transformative digestive tracts of any animal on the planet. And the first place that any chomp of grass or living plant or whatever else we are feeding cows makes it into their body is the rumen. You can picture it as basically a very interactive living compost operation. And it's really important to the health of the animal that their rumen be functioning normally. It's the heart of their microbiome, and so everything that the animal pulls into its body, its microbiome is transforming in some way, transforming things into different kinds of metabolites, molecules, compounds, energy sources. And this is hugely important to the health and well-being of our ruminants. And what do these microbes thrive on? They thrive on fresh plant matter. They ferment it and transform it into all of these other things. And when the rumen is functioning normally, we get the benefits of that. We get the right kind of fat profile. So we need an array of fats in our bodies that do a lot of different things, everything from modulating inflammation to assisting with our vision, and so on. And the other thing when the rumen is functioning normally is we get a really nice balance of micronutrients and phytochemicals. It transfers through to meat and dairy items in the human diet. And so I really think David and I believe that farming practices matter immensely to the human diet, and we need to get them to better jive with the biological bazaar. And so how do we do that? We got to knock off on the weapons, knock off on the toxins, and let the biology work normally and work how it has long worked. And this is how we're going to turn that trend around. This is how we're going to take poor soil, turn it into better soil, healthy soil that's going to ripple up through crops and animals and into us. And now with that, I'm going to turn it over to David, and he's going to tell you a little bit more about some of the research that we did for the new book.
So I'm also very happy to be here with the Bioneers community and to follow up on what Anne was introducing for our new forthcoming book, What's Your Food Ate? That book is really the outcome, the capstone, if you will, for a series of books that we started writing about a decade ago, looking into the relationship between humanity and the land, and the way that the land, how we treat the land in turn affects how the land can treat us. In Dirt, we looked at the history of how ancient societies treated their land and how that contributed to the downfall of society after society. The hidden half of nature looked at the biological basis for soil fertility that was sort of the neglected piece of 20th century and 21st century agriculture. And then in Growing a Revolution, we looked at how regenerative farming practices can start to heal the land. And that's the foundation for what Anne left you with in terms of thinking about how to build soil health into human health. And there's other advantages to regenerative agriculture in terms of the benefits farmers and society can derive from it. And there's a fairly simple recipe that we learned about in Growing a Revolution of sort of three pieces of agriculture that are fairly counter-conventional, but that are the key to building a regenerative agriculture that can restore soil health and fertility to degraded farmland. And that boils down to three things: minimize disturbance of the land, which can translate into no-till farming. It's not disturbing the life in the soil, maintaining a permanent ground cover, which in practice translates into maintaining a cover of living plants in the ground, cover crops, both in between crops in a rotation, and sometimes even in between crops in rows for row cropping, and also growing a diversity of crops. These three elements, minimal disturbance, keeping the ground covered, and diversity of crops, translates into cultivating the beneficial life in the soil, which promotes soil health, builds soil fertility, but also does things for farmers and for consumers as well. What does that look like? Well, it looks like the difference between the two soils that are on the screen now. The one in Gabe Brown's right hand holding up there is soil on a regenerative farm that's been rebuilt from soils that looked a lot like the soil in the lower hand, the left hand there. You'll notice the color difference. That's organic matter. That's carbon in the soil. And the carbon in the soil, it translates into food for microbes. It translates into soil health. But what does that do for farmers and for society at large? Well, there's a number of benefits before we get into the impact on the quality of our food. And it can result in higher profits for farmers. Why? Because if they can harvest comparable yields using less fertilizer, less pesticide, and less fossil fuel, that translates into a better bottom line for farmers. That's what really started to turn me into an optimist on this whole question of soil degradation, rebuilding the fertility of land, is that if it works for farmers, it could catch on. And that could, those the benefits could also spread wider through society, because that could result in more carbon captured from the atmosphere and put into the ground. The color differences, and as I'll show you in a minute, the differences in soil organic matter between regenerative and conventional farms translates into carbon taken out of the atmosphere and parked in the ground, where it can do humanity good rather than become a problem as it is in the atmosphere. And it also results in less offsite pollution. If we're using fewer nitrogen fertilizers, it translates into less offsite pollution that escapes from farms. But what about the question that Anne was leaving you with in terms of what it means for the quality of our food? That's the question that we really try and build on and tackle in What Your Food Ate. And as part of that, we both looked into the scientific literature to review, you know, what's been known in the history of the relationship between agronomy and nutrition, and thinking about that over the last few centuries. But we also went out and ran a bit of an experiment where we took 10 farms around the country. That map on the upper part of the screen there shows you 10 locations around the United States where we located regenerative farms that had converted worn out soil, like the example I just showed you, into richer, darker, black earth kind of soils over the course of a decade or two. And we paired those farms with adjacent conventional farms where regenerative practices had not been used over the same time period. And we took soil samples and crop samples from those 10 pairs of farms and compared them. And the graph at the bottom of the screen on the left-hand side shows you the difference between soil organic matter, carbon in the soil, between the regenerative farms shown in blue and the conventional farms shown in red. And you notice the spread is, you know, there's variation in both types of farms, but those blue ones plot higher than the red ones. The regenerative farms on average had about twice the soil organic matter, twice as much carbon in their topsoil. And they started with about the same level as their neighboring farms. The graph on the right in the bottom basically shows you the difference in soil health through what's something that's known as the Haney test. It's a metric of soil health that one can use to compare that includes both soil carbon and the activity of microbes in the soil. And the point again is that those blue data plots higher than the red data. The regenerative farms had 2 to 3 times the soil health score as the conventional farms. So essentially you can show that regenerative farming practices can increase the amount of carbon in at least the topsoil and the health of the topsoil. But what happens to, what was the difference in the crops? So we basically had both the conventional and the regenerative farms in each of those pairings grow the same crop variety of the same crop, literally in the same sort of soil type, but that had been farmed differently for the past few decades. And we compared different nutrients in samples of crops, whether peas, corn, sorghum, soy, or cabbage. Each farm pair grew a different crop. And what we found on average is are significant differences in the vitamin content, you know, a third more vitamin K, 17% more vitamin C, more vitamin E, more vitamin B1 in the regenerative crops. And we also found consistent differences in phytochemicals. We tested for carotenoids, total phenolics, and phytosterols. They had, you know, 15 to 22% more in the regenerative crops than in the conventional crops. In terms of mineral comparisons between the regenerative and the conventional crops, it was much more variable, but the statistically significant differences that we found were the ones that are shown up here on the screen, with more in calcium in soy and sorghum, copper in soy and sorghum, zinc, potassium, phosphorus as well. So there are more vitamins and more of certain minerals in the regenerative crops. We also partnered with Paul Brown at Brown's Ranch in North Dakota, looking at the data that they had collected in terms of livestock, beef and pork raised on on their regenerative farm, which is one of the farms in the comparison, the national comparison that we used. And you'll notice that for beef and pork, there are more omega-3 fatty acids, very beneficial, very health promoting. There was 2 to 3 times more of it in the regenerative livestock than in the conventional livestock. If you think of it in terms of the ratio of the omega-6 fatty acids to omega-3 fatty acids, that's the graph on the bottom right. the ratio is very different for the regenerative than for the conventional. For this, you want a low value. You want a lot of omega-3s and not many omega-6s. So that translates into a low omega-6 over omega-3 ratio. And you notice that the regenerative livestock has just a fraction of that ratio than the conventional. And we go into the details of that and the health impacts of that kind, that ratio and these different fats a lot in the book. But what we are quite comfortable left saying at the end of the day, after doing the research in the peer-reviewed literature, doing some of our own testing and visiting many of the farms that we were writing about, is that regenerative farming appears that it can actually double the carbon in topsoil over the course of a few decades. It's not going to solve the climate crisis just with that, but it is a positive step in the direction of enhancing not only soil fertility, but taking some carbon out of the atmosphere. It also can increase the quality of the food that's grown on farms, converting from conventional to regenerative practices, according to our data. It could increase the phenolics, phytosterols, and carotenoids in crops, increase the phytochemical levels that Anne was talking about. But it also can increase certain vitamins and certain minerals in certain crops. Again, that's more variable, but it's very interesting. And it can increase the omega-3 content of both meat and dairy as we go further into the book. In other words, it appears that there actually is support for the idea that regenerative farming practices captured in these principles as they're applied to the land can affect the quality of human food in ways that are health beneficial. That is essentially the message that's coming out of What Your Food Ate. We're very delighted that we've actually finally finished the book, and that'll be coming out early in 2022. Obviously, we encourage people to check out the arguments in it. But we're happy to share the news that we've completed that. So on behalf of both Anne and I, thank you for your attention and for the invitation to address the wonderful Bioneers community. Thank you.